How and when did you start doing music, and especially producing music?
I grew up around music. My sisters used to play and my mother used to buy albums. And I like the way, you know, I just like the way music made me feel. It was pretty obvious that I would be a musician. I started making music when I was roughly about 15 or 16 years old. I started playing a Casio keyboard. And from there, I went to, real piano, guitar. So I play drums, guitar, and piano.
You are well known for using a lot of live instruments in your productions. What made you decide to use so many live instruments in your music?
Well, because it made me, you know, I was in a band when I was young, so I grew up like, you know, wanting to play instruments, and sometimes samples are rigid, you know, they could be monotonous. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I wanted to put real instruments so to make the songs not so boring. I wanted to make the songs a little bit longer than regular rap songs, you know, longer than 2.5 and 3 minutes. So that in order to do rap songs that are 4 minutes, you gotta have, it seemed to me that you would have to have instruments. We're all inspired by Ohio, the Ohio music scene. Ohio Players, Slave, Mass Production, Zap, you know, all the Ohio stuff.
Is one of the reasons to use live instruments and to replay samples to avoid copyright issues?
Yeah, sometimes, but still, we ended up sampling anyway. Like, we didn't care. You know what I mean? Like, if something was good, I used it. But they, you know, our lawyers, you know, we were told to not use samples because of, you know, we wouldn't make any money. So if we didn't sample, we get a bigger piece of the pie for every dollar that came in. So we tried to use more original music or replay the samples so that we could, you know, so that we wouldn't, you know, just be giving somebody all our money.
What is your favorite sample that you used in your productions?
Favorite is Richard Pryor, like all the Richard Pryor stuff. His voice is great. And that's for the words, but as far as music goes, my favorite sample was probably Clear, the group Clear, K-L-E-E-E-R. Me and Dr. Dre used it. Dre used it for California Love. I used it for Tonight.
Your first solo album, Quick Is The Name, is released in 91. Now, almost 25 years later, how do you look back to that album and that time?
I'm proud. I'm glad that it happened. It changed my life. You know, I became, you know, I made a statement, and I feel like I put a brick into the wall of West Coast hip-hop because I was green, and I was just coming from a place where it wasn't about money or famous. I was just doing music that reflect, you know, totally mirrored where I was living, where I was mentally, and what I was going through.
I think my favorite solo album from you is Safe and Sound.
Safe and Sound, yeah, that was a good record. It was totally musical, adventurous.
Yeah,
you know, it was my third album. You know, and it's a longer record. Plus, you know, I at that point I was pretty popular. I had Parliament Funkadelic. I had that girl Dion Knighton singing. I had Robert Bacon and, you know, a bunch of people playing drums. So Quick Smooth 3 is my favorite out of all of the songs that I've done. I grew up with jazz. My mother used to play a lot of jazz. So, you know, jazz is musical expression. And I guess I have more music than lyrics in my heart. You know, I wanted to express more music than lyrics sometimes.
What has changed in your music and in your style since the start of your career?
I thought I grew. I was told that you have to grow and change. If not, you know, you'll get stagnant and nobody will, you know, you'll get replaced. So I just tried to keep up with the times of what people were doing. And it seems like to me that nothing has really changed. It seems like it's just, you know, everything is about the 808 drum machine, you know, and it's been that way since the 808 drum machine first came out. So I tried to be creative and do more musical score, film score, add, you know, movie elements to my music to make it more, you know, more visual. You know what I mean? Like where you could almost see what I'm playing. And lyrically, I tried to stay away from the, you know, the drugs and guns and, you know, gangs and shit. I tried to stay away from that. But everybody wants me to do that kind of music. It's like, so I'm pretty much stuck. You know, when it comes to my fans, they want to hear the hard. They call it hard. They want the hard music. And sometimes I'm not like that. Sometimes I'm, you know, I play piano. Like it's hard too to do live shows because I like to play piano and guitar. And it's like my fans, they say they don't want it. They just want the regular shit until they realize that I can really play. And then after the fact, they say, oh, you know what? Actually, that was pretty good. Quick and he can play guitar. Wow, did you see me? He was really playing the guitar. But it's, you know, it's after the fact. It's like you can't grow in hip-hop. You have to stay one way. So with my new music, I'm just going back to what I used to do. It's the famous, the quick is your name style. You know, I'm going to start, you know, be scratching. Really abrasive music, you know, cursing, all that old shit.
Now, I would like to talk about your time at Death Row and your friendship with Shirk Knight. How and when did you start working for Death Row Records?
I started working for them in, right when I was doing Safe and Sound, like in 1993, 1994. Because I had known Shirk, I knew him before he got famous. So he came and found me and was like, you know, what's Quick doing? He saw that, Shirk saw that we were all getting jerked around by Profile Records. So he wanted to come help. He wanted to manage us and give us more money from those companies because he knew we were going gold and platinum. We didn't have the money. Like they were like, you know, robbing us. So he came to help out.
How was your friendship at Shirk Knight before you start working with him on Death Row?
Well, Shirk Knight was great, man. He was a righteous dude, man. Everybody liked him. I met him through DLC and, you know, when they were Funky Enough Records, and he signed me to a contract before I got my contract with Profile Records. So I was actually signed with Suge and his company in like 1989 on the strength of the song Tonight and Black Pussy, Sweet Black Pussy.
What is your opinion about that a lot of people are still dissing Suge Knight?
Yeah, I'm not bashing him no more. I don't, he made some mistakes, but he's a human being. You got to forgive and forget. If people, you know, just keep... You know, if you don't forgive, then you'll just be one of the other bitter haters, you know, in the pool of the cesspool of the internet hate club. We should call them the internets. That's what the haters are. They're the internets.
You was never officially signed to Death Row, right?
Yeah, I never got signed. I wanted to. I really wanted to be on the roster, but I couldn't get out of my contract.
Is this one of the reasons that your real name, David Blake, is used in the credits for the All Eyes on Me album?
Yeah, that was one of the reasons, because Profile was, they wouldn't let Suge use my likeness. They threatened to sue him if he used my real name, if he used my stage name. So Suge decided to just use my real name so that it wouldn't be, he wouldn't get into trouble. It was legal jargon, but, you know, I'm not mad. I was really, because I really wanted to be a part of Suge's label. I really wanted to be with Snoop Dogg and Dr. Dre. That's what I wanted to be. That's what I always wanted to be. I wanted to sign with Priority Records before I signed with Profile. I wanted to be part of NWA. Mm-hmm. But Brian Turner at Priority, he didn't want to sign us. He said he already had an NWA. He wasn't interested in me and AMG.
Now I would like to talk about another song that you did together with Tupac and the Dog Pound. The name of the song is NY87, and that song is a diss song against the East Coast. Can you remember that song? And do you have any memories about that song?
Yeah, I have memories. It was a tumultuous time then, because we weren't, you know, the Source magazines and the magazines that, you know, the powers that be on the East Coast, all the media really came from the East Coast. And they didn't really respect us. As much as we were selling records across the world, across the globe, they didn't respect us. Mm-hmm. They didn't want to acknowledge us. It was almost like the amount of disrespect was just crazy. It was on purpose, too. It was intentional. When all we wanted to do was acknowledge them, show them love, and and be respected, because, you know, yeah, we all know hip hop started in the East. That's where we were coming from. So, you know, I was young. I was like 23, 24 when that record was done. Mm-hmm. So I was pretty much a kid, and I was, you know, I would express myself. I was a little emotional, you know what I mean? And I was also angry. I was very angry, you know.
Is Daz the producer of the song NY87?
That was Daz. He just had, I did the intro. One of those projects that didn't see the day.